Episode 3 of The Anthony Anderson Show is brought to you by usgoldcoins.com. That's 1-800-HOT-COIN. And Mezzi Grill. That's mezzigrill.com. And mountgox.com. That's mtgox.com. Greetings, everyone. This is Anthony coming at you from New York City on The Anthony Anderson Show on onlyonetv.com. Today, we're here with a forest gardener. This is Mark from roots2fruits.biz. How's it going, brother?
It's going really well. Thank you for having me, Anthony.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. We actually met yesterday for the first time. We'd known each other through Facebook and the internet and sharing the love of food forests and forest gardening. And it was very unexpected surprise to have you on today.
Oh, thank you.
Pretty cool, man. Pretty cool. So tell me about forest gardening. What does forest gardening, food forest mean to you? How did you get into it?
I got into it about 5 years ago.
Okay.
After I became interested in permaculture design and sustainability and really sparked by my love for food. So trying to figure out how to grow my own foods because I learned that that's the best way to get fresh food and fruits and everything like that. And then I picked up Dave Jackie's books, Edible Forest Gardens, Volume 1 and 2.
Okay.
And was fortunate enough that he came to Michigan to teach a workshop. And so I was able to go to his workshop. And after that, long story short, I just became addicted to growing plants and became sort of a plant geek. So I started doing lots of research and buying plants and planting them and growing them and figuring out what they, how they like to grow and all these different things.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been kind of a intuitive journey for me.
Very cool.
Kind of sparked by a love for food pretty much.
Yeah, same here.
So through that though, I've gotten interested in, you know, all these different things that relate to sustainability and, you know, simplified living and whatnot.
Cool.
So to me, forest gardening is basically, the most simple way to put it would be using nature's model of gardening to produce the things that humans need to make a living on Earth. So food and fiber and fuels and our medicines and our enjoyment.
Good point.
And our healthy living spaces.
Yeah.
So using useful plants and creating ecosystems is basically the general underlying principle of forest gardening is creating an ecosystem that will sustain itself, but also sustain us as humans.
Sure, sure. Do you see forest gardening playing a role in the future as far as sustainability, like the whole eco-village movement? Do you see it taking on?
Definitely. Maybe not so much the eco-village movement, as far as I know, is definitely utilizing forest gardening and permaculture design in their planning. But I see forest gardening having a very powerful impact on farming and agriculture in general because a lot of people know now, thanks to people like Michael Pollan and all these all this publicity that farming is getting right now, that the way that we grow food currently, the way we source calories is basically eroding topsoil and polluting land and whatnot. So forest gardening offers a lot to farmers because it allows them to incorporate perennial plants into their farming systems, and essentially allows farms to return to the underlying principle of being able to pass them on to generations that come after each farmer. So I see a really powerful impact on farming, and there's some great examples, some really, really forward-thinking, cutting-edge farmers out there that are doing this, that are planting trees. And a lot of them are developing or expanding on markets that already exist, like with the chestnut and the hazelnut, which some people would refer to as like niche markets, but they're actually worldwide, you know, they're commodity crops. So definitely I see that having a huge impact. And then on the flip side, also with homeowners and people that, you know, individuals, it also, I feel like, will have a significant impact along with growing vegetables and this whole victory gardening, you know, home garden resurgence. That you know, the most seed sales in history is what I've been reading. Like the past few years, they've just been increasing. Fedco Seeds in Maine, which I buy a lot of seeds from, last year put out a bulletin that 1 week they sold like $100,000 in seeds, which they'd never done before. So, yeah, it's definitely people are seeing that growing food at home is a worthwhile investment. Mm-hmm. And a few people, you know, a small number of people are seeing that it's actually a more worthwhile investment than a lot of the financial investment instruments that we're using currently in our economy. So
yeah, I feel that.
Those two, I feel like, because you have to have those two really for it to work out. So this idea of people planting jungles in their front and backyard and then farmers planting trees and, you know, producing bulk calories and then people growing fruits and vegetables at home, because those are what have the most transport and they're basically water weight. So if people grow them at home, it's the most sensible, it's the most energy efficient. Mm-hmm. You could literally pick your berries, eat them or preserve them right then. So
from my
experience, I feel like that is forest gardening has the most potential there.
Really cool, really cool. You mentioned the farmers taking part. What kind of stuff would they be most interested in planting?
Well, in terms of forest gardening and in like food production in particular, definitely the tree crops, nut trees in particular. There's a National Nut Growers Association, and then most states also have nut growers associations.
Cool.
And there's a lot of research going into improving varieties of walnuts and hickories and chestnuts and hazelnuts as like the four main northern to some of the more mild southern climates. So those four nuts and then the hazelnut as a shrub are probably going to be some of the main, because if we look at our system right now, it's corn and soybean, and then in third is like wheat and other cereal grains.
Mm-hmm.
So chestnut, which most people don't know, is nutrient-wise and calorie-wise very similar to rice.
Okay.
So from a market perspective, that is most advantageous for farmers because they can produce something that almost anyone could eat. Even if you have nut allergies, most people can eat chestnuts. So.
Okay.
They're quick to bear within 8 years, and so things like that. But beyond just the specific crops, the systems that farmers are starting to use more and more are systems known as agroforestry.
Mm-hmm.
And there's quite a range. There's like habitat, windbreaks and buffers, soil stabilization, and then a huge one is this forest farming concept where we're using trees in conjunction with other plants that are useful and have some yield. So there's a system known as alley cropping that is really popular that a lot of these hazelnut growers are using to transition into perennial income streams. They grow, they'll grow barley or rye or any, you know, they'll grow a number of annuals in rows between their rows of hazelnuts or chestnuts. And so from year one, they can reap some income from that planting. And then, you know, up to like 5 to 10 years, when the trees start yielding, they can phase out a lot of their alley crops.
And that's cool.
Those crops become their main income.
That's cool.
And they can move on and start doing more plantings and use those as seed source and whatnot. So alley cropping, I feel like, it's catching on. There's a lot of the farming conferences and the farmers that do a lot of these talks are demonstrating what they're doing on their farms with alley cropping and showing that it's actually profitable, that it's working.
Yeah, very nice.
So
that's really important. And because no matter what, we can be so into this cutting edge stuff, but if it doesn't make financial sense for them,
right,
at least within a couple of years, I don't think they're going to go for it.
Right. That's the biggest with farmers. Now, there's also kind of an edge to that as well, because some of these things are things people don't really eat commonly in America.
Mm-hmm.
Chestnuts and hazelnuts are more rare. In Europe, it's much more common, much more traditional.
Yeah.
So there's also that cultural aspect of kind of like that reskilling idea that people will have to learn how to use these foods and cook with them.
Yeah.
So that's maybe a longer term process, but you know, if the farmers are providing it, it's, well, I feel like it.
Yeah, and they can just put it into products too. I mean, they could be putting chestnut flour
into
pancakes and, you know, whatever.
Yeah, there's a farmer who's doing this, who's growing stuff like this, and a few of the interviews I've heard from him, he makes this joke, you know, Cheetos. He's like, well, you can take chestnuts and you can make Cheetos with them. So you can make anything with chestnuts because it's just a simple starch and it can be ground into flour. So you could theoretically have chestnut junk food. I mean,
chestnut Cheetos. Cool. Very cool. So Roots to Fruits, what's the story about that? How did that kind of come into fruition, so to speak? I'm sure that's come up before.
Well, the idea sort of germinated. Me and my lifelong friend, Trevor Newman, we grew up together. I knew his brother since I was in preschool. Mm-hmm. He was still in high school. I was kind of phasing out of going to college and following that path.
Okay.
So restructuring my life and trying to figure out what I wanted to do, what my life purpose was, we kind of synchronistically fell upon forest gardening and permaculture design, and along with my brother. And so we kind of like, you know, with our collective energy, we're able to like really get each other pumped up and try a bunch of different things and grow a bunch of stuff. So mm-hmm. Just sort of a natural evolution of that. We're all gardening, we're all doing all this stuff. We ended up meeting some friends through some mutual connections who were already doing this for a few years and had semi-established forest gardens. Uh-huh. And with my background, I used to do graphic design. So I had a natural tendency for design. So we just, you know, I don't know exactly how it evolved, but we just one day thought, well, why don't we rethink this idea of landscaping and the way that we interact with our landscapes instead of using lawns and these boring, useless plants that people just trim and don't really harvest anything off of. Mm-hmm. Why don't we create a business that helps people grow food? So mm-hmm. just sort of, it was very intuitive. It wasn't like we didn't really plan it out, just kind of happened, and it we rolled with it. We thought it was a great idea, and we're able to land a few jobs with our experience in our own gardens and you know, working on farms. We felt like we had enough experience to help people make it happen, so we were able to land some jobs, and those went well, and we learned a lot, and we figured it's a good thing to do. It seems like there's enough interest. Mm-hmm. So Roots to Fruits, as it now stands, is an ecological design firm, and it's currently Trevor and I as like lead designers and consultants. And our main mission really is to help people take their resource-consuming landscape and make a resource-producing
very
landscape.
Cool.
So taking this idea of like a net loss investment in your landscape and turning it into a net gain. Mm-hmm. So we consult for folks. We've done some consulting for one farmer so far. We're trying to work into getting into the agricultural field.
Yeah.
So consulting has been pretty big for us. Also, design has been our main thing. Mm-hmm. We do anywhere from very simple design to full master plan designs. Our most recent one was like a 30-acre master plan for up to 10-year phases.
Cool.
And then we've also been propagating plants and then also planting these gardens mm-hmm. and maintaining them. So that's kind of our broad range of services. And now we're moving more into education and giving workshops and presentations to our community and trying to kind of stoke that fire of, you know, getting people interested in this stuff, because it's kind of a new thing. So that's worked out really well for us. When we describe to people what we do, they're excited and they think, wow, I've got this lawn that I just cut and I'm wasting all this money and I don't get anything out of it. And so it's kind of like this thing that's starting to click in people's minds. So
do people understand quickly how easy it can be once it's established? Do they does that sink in on like their first workshop? Or I mean, because it's really compared to the Victory Garden style with like the raised veg and the raised beds and everything, it's just the forest gardening seems to be so much easier once everything is mulched and you have it all planted and like your mint and this and that, and mm-hmm. it's all kind of filled in. And I just really want people to really get that, how easy it is.
Definitely in our experience, like presenting to people that do garden already, they're more apt to comprehend what that means, especially people We've had a lot of clients that are kind of into this native plant movement. Mm-hmm. So they kind of get it because they're looking at ecosystems and they're seeing how these plants grow with each other. So for them, it makes sense.
Yeah.
But I think conceptually, a lot of people have had trouble. We've had to do a lot of kind of like mentoring with some of our clients to help them understand how these things evolve and mm-hmm. what's going on. Why are we planting, like you're saying, like, why are we planting mint and white clover with our fruit bush?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So we've used kind of our design mm-hmm. edge to make visual diagrams and kind of like mm-hmm. make it a little more sensory for folks mm-hmm. so they can see it. And people are definitely getting it. The edible landscaping service that we've kind of been marketing, it I think makes a lot more sense.
Yeah.
And the forest gardening is maybe like a more esoteric, if you will, form of edible landscaping that we're trying to like wean people into.
Definitely.
Because all the edible landscapes we've done are essentially forest gardens. I mean, mm-hmm. we're just not calling it that. Mm-hmm. So people are definitely slowly, it's starting to make sense. And they're seeing that the work they're putting into it, for example, the first 2 years when they have when they plant to the forest garden, they have to mulch and maybe do some occasional weeding until the plants start to mature. They're seeing that investment as like very worthwhile because eventually everything will be so mature that the weeding and work will be very minimal. The main work is harvesting, really, because that actually does take a lot of time to harvest all those berries and preserve them. So,
mm-hmm. My mom was complaining the other week. She's like, because she picked like about 2 gallons, I guess, of raspberries.
Oh, nice.
She's like, it took me 2 hours today. And I was sweating and there's mosquitoes. And I was like, geez, so sorry, you know? Like,
yeah, 2 gallons.
Enjoy. It is work, though, especially in the summertime when it's like beaming down on you and, you know, gooseberries and you're getting thorns.
Yeah,
and
some of those plants are definitely thorny.
It gets old for some people.
So kind of tying back into the farming thing, there is a cultural aspect to it. So mm-hmm. you know, over the past 50 years or so, our culture is kind of degraded, and work has kind of become this service kind of idea, and, mm-hmm. and labor has kind of been relegated to the lower classes. I don't want to say classes. We don't have
we do
have a class system, but
yeah,
it's informal. So I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but a lot of the folks I've been meeting that are into gardening and they're like realizing how important it is to have clean, fresh food, realize there's a sacrifice, especially with the CSA movement. A lot of the CSAs, which for folks that don't understand what that is basically like a community-supported farming where people invest in their vegetable share for a year and they help the farmer grow it.
Mm-hmm.
But with that movement, a lot of the CSAs require their members to work a certain amount of hours.
Mm-hmm.
So within that realm of like local food, there are people that have had experience on farms and no labor. And so to them, it makes sense. You know, people that are canning and stuff like that, they realize it's not easy in the sense of like taking your frozen food out of the freezer and microwaving it,
which
is maybe you could define that as easy.
But
it is easy. This is one way I like to word it when people ask me this question is, if you think of all the energy that's going into those raspberries you bought at Whole Foods that are in a plastic container, it's a whole system of energy invested in that one container mm-hmm. that you don't even see or even think about. So first of all, the field had to be tilled, those plants had to be propagated, they had to be planted, watered, maintained, pruned, some sort of nutrient had to be put on them, then they had to be harvested, sorted, packed, the plastic had to be manufactured, the trucks had to be manufactured. It's a huge system. So there's so much energy going into that there's a lot of work. And so picking 2 gallons of raspberries and sweating and maybe getting bit by some mosquitoes is like nothing compared to that energy.
Oh, such a big system. That's crazy.
And so on the cultural level, I feel like that's maybe the biggest thing with permaculture design and the things we're doing is that people don't think in systems generally. So our whole society is this very complex system, so we don't even see the energy inputs into a lot of the things we do, so mm-hmm. and we don't feel them.
Mm-hmm.
So some of those things are foreign, like work seems hard to some people, but if they realize how much of a slave fossil fuel is for us, they would see that their sweat and their labor is very easy compared to what fossil fuels are doing for our car or buses or airplanes or whatever.
Yeah, so. good point. Speaking of cars, you're based out of Michigan, right?
Uh-huh.
And what have you seen with Detroit and the whole resurgence of, I mean, what's happening with the degraded land over there, the abandoned land?
So in Detroit, it's been getting a lot of headlines lately. A lot of people are starting to talk about it and hear about it. I have very sparse experience actually there. I've visited and I've met a lot of people that are actually there doing the work. But from my observations, there's a lot of abandoned lands, a lot of neighborhoods that are virtually empty, no tenants or people living there taking care of it. So what's happening is low housing prices is drawing in a lot of young people, artists and entrepreneurs, and mainly from what I've read from the statistics, people with college degrees and things like that are moving in, taking advantage of all these opportunities. And there's a huge push and movement around this food security issue because there are so many people that they can't, because of their circumstances, are unable or it's made very difficult for them to acquire healthy, fresh, nutrient-dense food. Yeah. So there's actually a very large movement centered around that. And I feel like everything kind of is maybe a byproduct of that or a subset of that. So there's organizations that are setting up community farms and gardens. There's one fellow I met a few years ago, Patrick Crouch. He's works for Earthworks Farms, which is run by a soup kitchen, and they donate most of their produce to the homeless. So there's several things that are set up like that. There's now some market farmers. People are like seeing that you can actually make a living like on 3 acres in Detroit selling vegetables. So it's kind of like this huge, it's a mix. And then there's also this other aspect of what people would call like hipster culture, these young people who are starting these little businesses, entrepreneurial sort of things. There's kind of a strong foodie culture. A lot of people are really interested in food and bringing back like the preservation methods of the past. Doing meat curing and fermented foods and things like that. So it's really cool. From my perspective, it's like, I feel like that is such a great model for every urban center because it's likely that urban centers are going to become more and more populated, but also more and more strained for energy because of the energy usage that they take. So Detroit's a great example. It's a city that kind of fell apart, and now people are taking the infrastructure that's there and they're making it lively and like kind of like bringing back this whole community feel, and the food is really essential to that because people have to eat. And so food access is increasing, I'd say, and definitely the community aspect is, I'd say, is definitely increasing. I had a family that lived in Detroit, grew up in Detroit, and they kind of saw it degrade and they moved away and some stayed. I have an aunt who stayed there up until a few years ago, and she was trying to kind of like work within those systems, and it was very difficult. But now I feel like maybe the advantages are kind of coming full swing and it's becoming a little more, the doors are opening more for people that want to do these things. There's a lot of money coming into it. So with the whole car culture, the car culture is kind of phasing out. Realistically, it's phasing out, and Detroit is going to inherit a new, it's going to inherit a new symbolism, I feel like, beyond cars, because there's no cars made there anymore.
It's like, I think they're going to see a big rebirth of the old style. That's a big mentality too that people kind of have to think about, is that we're like living in this little blip of abnormality, and we're going to get back to that whole thing, and it's all like back to living with, you know, manure as fertilizer, and you know, everything's done by hand, and we're getting back to that really soon. So I think we're in that 100, 200 year weird period, maybe a little longer if you look at whatever, the Middle Ages and stuff, and going back a couple thousand years, but in the past 200, 300, it's been very strange.
Oh, definitely. It's been unusual for our species. I mean,
for the planet.
For any species, really.
It's amazing that everything's adapted the way it has, I mean, it feels like, obviously it's in a bad situation for a lot of other species and stuff, but considering what they've faced, I mean, humans have done so much, mm-hmm. unfortunately, so much destructiveness compared to what they could do. Have you mm-hmm. seen The Man Who Planted Trees, that animated film?
I haven't, but many people have recommended it to me.
Yeah, it's on YouTube, and just Google The Man Who Planted Trees on YouTube. And it should be a 4-part animated film that was made probably 20 years ago or something.
Oh, okay.
And it's about this, he was a sheep herder, a shepherd living in kind of near Provence in France. And he would plant 100 acorns a day.
Wow.
As he took his sheep out. And it was barren land because it was all deforested because of coal. They were making charcoal. And, you know, that was the whole thing. So all this forest was totally wiped away. Hmm. And you would see, like, the author or the narrator of the story, he was a young man when this all happened, and he was hiking through these desolated areas, and he'd find, like, abandoned villages with, like, a fountain, but the fountain was dry. Hmm. So this was like a spring that someone funneled in, and then they built their village around the spring.
Wow.
But now, since they cut all the trees down, the fountain was gone. Mm. And so this guy had been planting probably from like 1910 to 1940 or something. And he reforested like a 20-mile by 20-mile section.
Wow.
And all the water came back.
That's awesome.
Yeah, totally reforested. So it was something like 20,000 oak trees.
Wow.
And just like huge. And that was one guy just planting
seeds.
That's
amazing.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that was with a very small budget too. So if you think if someone with resources really gets into this idea,
yes.
and they really go for it, I feel like that's it. Like,
yeah.
I mean, really, once millions start getting put into this idea, it'll catch on really fast.
Yeah.
Check out that show. You'll like
it. I definitely
will. It's like 40 minutes long. It's great.
That sounds awesome. Wow, that's inspiring, because that's kind of like what we're doing, except we're doing it on a very small scale. We're planting these seeds. And
Well, luckily with the internet now, like when people see the website and they get inspired and they see what you've designed so far, and that's just like really inspirational for people. That's the beauty of the internet. I mean, mm-hmm. we're so lucky. But especially, you know, we can really, one person, that's what that film was all about, was just this one guy. And almost he had like the it was almost like an act of God. People thought, people didn't know that he did it. Most people didn't know, except this one guy. And people were like, what is going on? Like, they thought it was like an act of God that this forest came back.
Wow.
In the middle of nowhere. It was just like,
that's great.
And then it just showed what one positive person could do. And like one positive person can outshadow, I feel like, 1,000 neutral people that are just kind of living their life and getting by. And that's really like, once all this positivity starts spreading and people become like that and, you know, working on projects like what you're working on, then I think it's just gonna, and then they get into the food and the clean food, and people start having babies and they want their kids to eat clean food.
Yes.
That's like a big deal now.
It's huge.
I'm really hopeful. I don't know if it's going to be in the nick of time or what, but depending on, you know, finances and things, because people are really having the screws put on right now with the cost of food, and you know, everyone's still really getting sick, and it's just like this big double whammy, and people are losing their jobs. And so really for me, like the whole food forest idea was such an answer to all of it. And it just takes you out of that whole game, you know? Like, if you want to play the game, you can, but you don't have to because you have your food forest. And I can just see it catching on, and all the foodies and the hipsters getting into it. And
yeah, it's perfect.
How much does land sell for in Detroit? I mean, it's pretty...
I've heard some low prices, like $1,000, $2,000, $3,000 for... Yeah. I mean, for a pretty rundown house.
Well, yeah. But you got the land, at least.
Yeah, but the houses are still livable. I mean...
That's cool.
With some elbow grease, you could really, I mean, they're really nice houses, you know?
I went to this one in California, and it was a real long backyard. And there was the main house, and probably 10 people lived in this house. I think they call it the East House, and it's in Los Angeles. And in the backyard is a forest garden.
Oh, really?
They planted a lot of citrus and avocado, maybe like 10, 15 years ago.
Wow.
And then now there's new stuff kind of going through. And throughout the backyard, there's little one-bedroom pods that people have built
Whoa.
Underneath the canopy. So it's like these little, it might be a like a kind of a tent thing, but it's always waterproof, and they use like reclaimed materials, and it's like there's 10 people living throughout the backyard in these pods.
That's a cool idea.
I don't know what they do for the restroom. I think maybe there was a composting toilet kind of like in the corner or something, and there's a shower, but everyone had their own space, and they're able to support like 20 people on that property. And their goal was to, they thought about this year they were gonna get there where they their food costs would be almost zero.
Nice.
Because they're doing a lot of bulk buying in together, mm-hmm. and then they run a CSA out of their place.
Oh, really?
Where the farmers will bring all the stuff, and then they distribute it all out of that place, and then the forest garden in the back. So they're
That's a really great concept.
They're looking at supporting 10 to 20 people on, can't be more than an acre. It's a big property, but it's long, and it used to be a horse track part of it. Yeah, so I was wondering how fertile it is, if you know all the horses on there.
Probably pretty I mean, more so than most.
I mean, they're probably getting some manure, but
that's a really good idea because they're also living there. So that's kind of a key with forest gardening, is you have to be there to take care of it. There has to be a caretaker. So if there's people living in it, that's like perfect. Every day they're taking care of their plants, and the garden is like totally tended.
It would be perfect.
Yeah,
living in these things, and you know, visit someone in the next pod and hang out and have breakfast. And
that's great.
Yeah,
it's kind of like a building off that. I don't know if you've heard of this tiny house concept.
Yeah.
These like less than 1,000 square foot houses that people are building, putting them on trailers and like doing all this really interesting stuff.
Cool.
But it's really catching on. So that's kind of like building on that. It's like the kind of post-industrial tiny house forest garden movement.
yeah, really. It makes perfect sense, too, because I think sometimes people want to get the real big houses, but there's just so much upkeep. And it doesn't seem as appealing as it used to. I'd rather just have many small little pods and then a communal space for the kitchen and the bathrooms and stuff or whatever, but keep it small and simple.
Yeah.
And then individualize where people can tailor it to their own spot, and then you're just dealing with leaky roofs and all this stuff with these big houses. It just seems like a trap to me. It might be a blessing that some of these houses are dilapidated and they can just start fresh. And
yeah, you can scrap a lot of the material and repurpose it. And there's actually in another spot in Michigan, in Traverse City, which is northwest Michigan, there's actually a company that they take materials from demolition sites. So that instead of demolishing the building, they literally take it apart and then they resell that material. It's probably at a reduced rate, but they're selling it to people that are building stuff, and it's really working out.
Good.
It's a very successful model because there's so many resources. Someone in Detroit has got to be working on something like that.
Yeah. And it can kind of become an addiction when you get into collecting the resources, because you start seeing gold everywhere. You see like a pile of leaves on the corner, and somebody getting rid of like, I've seen like a mattress pad, or not a pad, but like the box frame.
Yeah,
and it was all like wood and
like
and
a trellis almost.
Yeah, I was like, well, you could take that apart in a couple pieces and make a trellis, and I mean, there's stuff everywhere.
Yes, there is.
You know, dead branches on the ground can be chipped up, and you know, people don't value it like permaculturists do.
Yeah, that's with our clients. That's one of the biggest things is like kind of along the lines of like mentoring. Instead of like telling people what they need to do, but instead like drawing them to those conclusions on their own. So like giving them these hints, and then they get these aha moments. So we've been doing some education to kind of bring people to those realizations to see that when you're throwing out your bag of leaves, you're throwing out a lot of fertility.
Yeah.
Or like when you mow your lawn and same thing, bag up your lawn clippings, you're getting rid of a lot of fertility. And and then composting is like a huge one. So many millions of tons of food waste just get thrown in landfills.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably enough raw material to make compost to like for probably every farm, every small farm in America, I'd imagine.
I would think so. I mean, there's so much waste.
So I feel like there's a lot of leverage with composting and the very simple things that we can do. Anyone can compost, even in the city. In the city, it takes a little more adaptation. You need to use different systems.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very, very possible. There's actually a woman, I would say at Union Square Market yesterday, and there's a woman who collects food scraps and compostable material, and then she sells it back to the public because people don't want it and they're excited about someone else doing something with it. Mm-hmm. So there's, I mean, that's a big one.
Yeah.
Because once we have compost, we have fertility, and then we have plants, and once we have plants, we're good.
Yeah. Yeah. Once the cycle's started. Yeah. That's the thing. You want to talk about, let's go to a break. We're going to talk about usgoldcoins.com, and that's 1-800-HOT-COIN. Andy Goss is the man. He has been my trusted advisor for investments in rare gold and silver coins for a long time now. check him out. His book, Uncle Sam Cooks the Books, is a masterpiece and should be read by everyone. And Mezzi Grill. Mezzi Grill is authentic Mediterranean food. They now serve breakfast. They're on 8th Avenue and 55th Street in New York City. And they're just south of Columbus Circle. And they're on the Clean Plates edition of New York City as well. Very cool. And then we've got Mt. Gox, which is online exchange services for Bitcoins. They now take Euros, British Pounds, and Australian Dollars. Canadian Dollars are coming soon. Very cool. Very cool.
Awesome.
Awesome. Well, let's talk about some of your favorite items that you'd want to plant. Like if someone comes to you and they maybe say, we'll each give our top five.
Okay.
So, and you're in a northern climate, as am I.
Uh-huh.
But maybe we'll do some southern options too.
Okay.
But let's say someone wants to know your favorite five or ten.
Okay. So if you have good sun.
Okay.
Relatively good access to irrigation water or rainfall. Top five would for me be American persimmon, which is either a small, medium, or very large tree. Mm-hmm. And can be pruned to be either of those three.
Okay,
so American persimmon.
Cool.
Red currant.
Okay. Interesting.
And as a side note to that, all currants, black, white, and then gooseberry, we'll slide that in there.
Yeah, yeah.
So the Ribes genus.
Yes.
Ribes. Yep. And then comfrey.
Okay, yeah.
Comfrey is definitely on top five. Comfrey is an amazing nutrient accumulator, compost plant, amazing medicine.
Yeah.
Definitely hazelnuts.
Okay.
And or chestnuts.
Okay.
And for the fifth one, it's so hard to choose.
Yeah, really? so many.
I would have to say fresh strawberries.
Cool.
Straight from the garden in June is like,
yeah,
that's beautiful.
Yeah.
So those five.
Nice.
Off the top of the dome.
Yeah, yeah. Gosh, there's so many. I like the American persimmon. That's cool to bring that up because not many people even know that it exists.
No. Or
that even persimmons exist.
Yeah. Some people know Asian persimmons.
The khaki fruits.
Yep. Khaki is as they call it in Japan. But the American persimmon is a true delicacy,
mm-hmm.
and its Latin name translates to the fruit of the gods.
Yes.
Which is Dirospiros. So it's very custardy, almost not custardy, very caramely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Date-like.
Yes.
Butterscotchy.
Sweet.
Jelly-like. Very sweet. Very high in sugar.
Mm-hmm.
Very nutrient dense, and just absolutely amazing. Ripens in around October.
Yeah.
You don't even have to pick the fruits. They fall to the ground when they're ripe.
Wow.
You can dry them. You can make pudding, ice cream, brownies, cookies, all these amazing treats.
Nice.
With the American persimmon. And they're just...
That sounds great.
There's actually a story I've heard. Family, 1930 maybe, actually subsisted mainly off of their American persimmons during a drought year, it was a bad crop year. Because they hang on the tree so long,
uh-huh.
and they're so calorie dense that they were able to harvest enough through the winter to have enough sustenance.
Wow.
So okay.
That's good
plant
to
some
know.
Persimmons and save the seeds.
Yeah, yeah. And that's a really good one to know because coming from the north, you're always thinking about winter survival
mm-hmm.
and nut trees and storage and everything, but knowing that there's still good fruits like that can hang.
Yep.
That's cool.
No. Every year they won't hang, but it's common for that to happen.
Yep. I was in California and there was an Asian persimmon and it was like January already, but it was California and a lot of them were just super ripe, just hanging on the thing, just squishy, you know, you just pop it off and eat it. I couldn't believe it. It was so we picked like 80 or 100
wow.
persimmons.
Wow.
Yeah. And they were all just so nice. And then you put them in the fridge and they ripen slowly and you know, it's a nice staggered
so
fruit.
Good. They store really well under cold storage.
Really well. I mean, it's surprising.
Because they're so high in sugar.
Yeah. Interesting.
So what are your top five?
Well, I would probably go with hazelnuts. And I planted most of my hazelnuts 2 years ago, so I'm just kind of waiting for them to really fill out and do their thing. Probably comfrey. I guess, you know, I would say white clover, too, because white clover is
White clover is great.
Yeah, it's just a low-maintenance lawn, you know, and wherever I walk, like my pathways, the flowers never really form, but everywhere else mm-hmm. the flowers come up. And it's maybe this high off the ground, mm-hmm. maybe a little more sometimes. And it's just super lush, and wow, the bees just go crazy.
Yeah, it's a great plant.
And you can mow it maybe 3 times every summer, you know, starting from maybe June until September or something. Give it a snip and get all the old flowers off, and it just keeps feeding your bees. Mm. It's really great. And what's nice is you can plant it in the ditches, and like no one really even knows that it's there, but it's almost like you're turning your public property, the public property in the ditch, into useful food for the bees, and you know, it fixes nitrogen. So I like rhubarb a lot too.
Yeah,
I mean,
rhubarb bees.
It's so low maintenance, and then it's one of the first ones in the spring to really kind of leaf out. And where I'm at in Minnesota, it's almost like Mother's Day and things are still pretty brown. I mean, they're leafing out, they're coming, but your rhubarb is like one of the first ones. Mm-hmm. It's already looking really nice. Gosh, maybe, and I'm waiting for this one to come in too, the sea buckthorn, the sea berries. I think that would be great because it's a nitrogen fixer and it's able to, you know, put out a nice berry. Otherwise, you know, once they get big, I think the Korean nut pine would be, I'm going to be really happy that I planted those.
Mm-hmm.
And once they're coming, but they're still like this, and I'm just kind of,
they're slow,
trying to egg them on, and you don't know what else you can do, you know, to make it click quicker. And currants, you know, I've had a lot more success with black as far as the deer damage.
Okay.
Like the deer have not touched the black currants, maybe a little nibbling, but they will beat up on the reds still for some reason, and the jostaberries, they'll beat up on the jostaberries.
Hmm. Probably because the black currant has such a strong scent.
Yeah
They probably don't like that.
Yeah, even the leaves they don't like. I mean, or they'll just nibble the buds in the fall or in the winter time. They'll just kind of nibble on the on the buds. Another one that I like is the Nanking cherry because the deer don't like it. Mm. And that's really, and it puts out a very early flower, kind of like a Juneberry. It's one of the first ones. That's the thing, like at the Highline Park in New York City.
Yeah, I saw that.
They planted most of those because it's an early ornamental.
Right.
I don't even think they did it for the wildlife value or the food value, but it's one of the first things to leaf out and flower really pretty. So in the springtime after a long winter, it's nice to see. And the Nankings are totally like that. I think if they knew about Nankings, they'd plant them. And it's more of a full sun variety, they say, but my parents planted maybe 6 of them in our driveway, and it's under an oak canopy, and there's maybe about 4 hours a day of direct, and the rest is kind of like shady, filtered, pretty shady. And they're still fruiting really well.
Really?
Yeah.
The Nankings?
Yeah.
Wow, that's encouraging.
So I planted a bunch where I'm at, and the ones that I mixed in with wood chips, like I mixed wood chips in with the soil, they're growing like 3 times as fast as the other ones that I planted in just the soil.
Huh.
Yeah.
What kind of wood chips? Were they hardwood?
You know, I think it was, but there was some cypress in there or some cedar. I know there was some, not a lot, but I could smell some of it. And it was just this massive pile of wood chips at the at a sand pit, like a gravel pit. And we would just fill up the truck, and I would just mulch everything really heavily and mix it in. And then 2 years later, all the mushrooms came up.
Mm.
And then they're just really big. They're real big. So now I'm just out like errant branches, you know, like cleaning up the branches, and they just new growth like crazy. So yeah.
I haven't heard that before, the mixing the wood chips in.
Yeah.
That's cool.
They really would have responded.
Hmm.
So yeah, I'm just planting more and more hazelnuts. I'm planting the hazelberts, which is the cross between the filbert and the hazelnuts. More, you know, better production with the cold hardiness still. Hardy kiwis, once it comes in. There's so many, man.
I could have top like 200 probably.
Once you get into it and you know like how well it does and what this is, it becomes such an addiction.
If you
find a good supplier with relatively good prices, I mean, it's just like, I'm a drug fiend. Just get more plants. Yeah, it's fun.
Well, just imagine when you're like, you know, like when you're like your parents' age, for example, you're going to be basking in so much food, you could just let most of it hang because there'd be so much.
It'd be so much. And I think that's really the key, is to overplant if you can. I mean, if there's limited space, whatever, but if you can, overplant it, because you're going to support a lot more animals.
Oh, yeah.
And then that's just intake, you know, your nutrient cycling just really increases, and then there's just more for everybody. And someone said, like, the only way to really protect a hazelnut bush is to be something like 500 feet away from the nearest other trees, because squirrels will just hit your hazelnuts. Or they say just plant a few extra ones and take it easy.
You know? Yeah, and if you live where there's a lot of oaks, I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
There's hopefully enough for.
Yeah, that would be a good one too, like a nice bur oak, white oak.
Actually, earlier when I was in Central Park, I saw a chestnut leaf oak.
Oh,
which
wow.
has the it has leaves that are like a very thin chestnut leaf almost.
No kidding.
But the fruit is it's in the white chestnut or sorry in the white oak family or group, so it has those big low tannin nuts.
Great.
So you might want to check those out in the fall.
Yeah, maybe harvest some and plant them next year.
Yeah.
It's and now I'm at the point where most of it's been planted, so I'm ready to just do stuff like that, just planting nuts around and seeing what comes up and. Just soak them, you know. It seemed like this guy was planting them nearly year-round.
Hmm.
But I don't know about that. It might have been like a seasonal kind of thing.
Yeah. But maybe in the movie they...
Yeah, they might not have covered it, but... Yeah. I don't know.
But that's like... that's probably the best way to do it, because that's what happens. The squirrel... Most of the time, it's the squirrels burying the nuts and forgetting where they buried it.
Yeah.
And then that germinates.
Yep.
I have that problem. Not problem. I have that advantage in my garden. Lots of oak trees come up because the squirrels buried them. Acorns.
Yeah. He would always soak them. I think that the story was like he would sort them out at night, and then he would soak them for 12 hours. And then when he went out in the morning with his goats, he would start planting them. And he had an iron rod. And he would just stick a hole in and then cover it in. And I think it was maybe like this deep for each one, he said.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah. Pretty nuts. That's a good show. Are you familiar with like some of the Fukuoka stuff, the no-till?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Yeah, there's one of the most recent things I saw related to that was a woman, I forget where she was, but she was doing some trialing, trying to do like a production style for vegetables using his methods, no-till. And what she did was she tilled the plot and seeded it extremely dense with white clover and I think red clover.
Okay.
Or crimson clover, I can't remember. One of the annual or biennial
clovers.
And then in her planting rows, she would just chisel plow the rows, so it would plow up that white clover and she would just plant right in there, and then the remaining white clover would basically fill the gap.
Yeah.
And next to it, she just had a regular plot that was just, you know, bare dirt, how they would normally do the row crops.
Uh-huh.
And she found like that it needed so much less water and almost no weeding. And at the end of the year, she didn't have to do anything because the clover was there and it was covering the soil. So she could just even leave the dead plants there and they would decompose. And the next year, she would just chop them down as mulch.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. So those methods those are definitely... When it comes to growing annuals, I feel like those are very, very, very powerful because realistically, we are going to need to grow annuals to feed humans for the next probably 50 years or so.
Yeah.
So like using those methods, I saw a really great article in Permaculture Activists last year. Some folks in Portland, kind of like, I guess you'd say almost like anarchist sort of guys, took all these abandoned lots or like were able to source these random lots all over, and they started like this grain CSA, and they were growing these heirloom corns and other grains on all these plots, so they had like all this food throughout Portland. And then they were able to build enough capital to get a seed cleaner and a seed sorter, and they're able to get like some storage space. So now I think they're at a level where they have like the CSA, so people buy a share, and then at the end of the season they get corn and all this local calories, you know, that are being grown in a responsible manner. They're putting back nutrients into the soil. They're not just denuding it and moving on to the next plot.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of cool things with annuals. Like sometimes I've noticed that maybe like perennials are extremely important, but we do need annuals. Like just for a caloric equation,
yeah,
we need them. So like people that are like figuring out these ways to do really creative ways to grow them so that they're not losing topsoil and they're not losing nutrients are really important. I saw another awesome one, Milkwood Permaculture wrote about this on their blog.
How do you spell it?
Milkwood.
Milkwood.
M-I-L-K-W-O-O-D.
Cool.
I think it's milkwood.net. If you check out their website, they have some really awesome stuff on permaculture.
Cool.
They wrote about one of their neighbors. He does this method of cropping called pasture cropping, where he takes a pasture that he grazes with cows or other livestock, and he uses a Yalman's chisel plow, which is a plow that has anywhere from 3 to 5 chisel plows, which are about 16 inches long, and they're L-shaped plow that are very skinny. And so they're not actually turning the soil, they're digging into the subsoil and creating these channels that allow oxygen and soil, or sorry, H2O water into the soil. And in those channels, while he's plowing it, he's has a machine that drops a seed in there for rye or wheat. And so he'll do that, and then he'll graze the paddock, and then those seeds will germinate, the grain will grow. And in Australia, it's droughty, so the pasture grass kind of goes dormant, but his grains keep growing because they're in those channels and they're getting irrigated. And at the end of the year, he harvests. After he harvests, they get a rain and he grazes it again. So he's making a living doing that, growing grains and also meat. So that's a, something I feel people in maybe in more southern climates where they get a little less rain could try that out. So that's kind of the stuff when we work with farmers. We want to work with perennials and like alternative cropping systems, alternative, you know, things that they can sell, but also like improving annual systems.
Improving the annuals,
Because that's huge. I mean, you know, 90% of the food we eat is an annual, so it grows, it dies all in 1 year.
It'd be interesting to do like an only perennial diet for a while, see if that would be possible.
Yeah, people have done it. My friend Ethan, he and his girlfriend, they tried to, I think they did it for like, they tried first for like a month, I think. They're trying to do like 50% perennial. I think they're just, they're trying to, by 2011, have like a 90, 80 or 90% perennial diet. So, it's totally feasible.
It'd be more, a little more nut-based maybe.
Yeah, next time you're at the store, buy, instead of buying a pound of flour, go and buy 2 pounds of hazelnuts. And get creative, make all sorts of stuff with them. I mean, you could
coconut stuff, coconut products. That's perennial.
Yeah, coconuts, even even tropical stuff. I mean, if we can figure out how to transport it,
All the fruits. Yeah, it's possible.
It's definitely possible. It's you have to be very creative, very very committed.
Open-minded too, because there's so many things and all the other stuff. But well, very cool. Are there any other websites you want to mention before we go? Just turning some people on to some new ideas. Anything that you've been into lately?
Lately, well, for the past year, I've been getting extremely excited about wild food and foraging and basing my diet a lot around wild food and what's available in the wild. So I'm actually working on teaching folks how to identify, harvest, and cook wild foods. So that's kind of my next little mini project.
Great.
Other than that, check out our website, and there none come to my mind that are, there's so many good websites. If you check out ours, we have a resource page that has a good list of stuff that we check out regularly.
And that's roots2fruits.biz.
Yep.
And that's all spelled out. R-O-O-T-S-T-O FRUITS.BIZ. So for any illiterate folk out there. Cool, very cool. Well, man, thanks so much.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's been really cool. I look forward, you're doing the permaculture convergence this weekend.
This weekend in High Falls, New York.
Yeah, keep me posted on that.
Anyone out there, Saturdays, $20, all public are invited, and there's all sorts of workshops and all sorts of cool stuff if you're into learning about more ways to simplify your life and reduce your consumption needs.
Very cool. And that's put on by the Green Phoenix Permaculture Group.
Yep. And a few other folks. The Northeast Permaculture Institute.
Cool.
Or the Permaculture Institute of the Northeast, which is Pine and believe Finger Lakes Permaculture Institute, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, that'll be great. So everyone check that out if possible. And check out Mark's site, see what he's up to, and see if maybe he can be of service. Don't be afraid to give him a call and see what's going on. Thanks so much, bro. One more handshake. Anthony. Very cool. I'm Anthony Anderson, and see you next time. Thanks so much. Cool.